it feels like what's happening in America, this is a long walk, but you'll get the transition, that there are people who believe they are down south, particularly down south over the weekend, who are expressing their view of the world, and they're feeling empowered in a certain way and saying, well, this is how I see things. This is how I have felt for the last 10 years. I still remember there's a woman who was being interviewed during Inauguration Day, and she said, how liberals feel today is how I have felt for the last 8 years, scared. And I hadn't seen the world through that lens in a long time. So where does, you know, in law it is you have the right to swing your fist until you touch the person in front of you's nose. Where does onlyness stop when it starts to impact someone else's? Where does one onlyness begin and the other one stop?
This is a really important question because, in fact, when Roger critiqued the book, Roger Martin, who some of you might know at Rotman, he thought one story was basically about, well, this person's opinion wasn't being validated. And I said, it doesn't mean like it's a free-for-all, right? When you join together in onlyness, you're agreeing on a shared objective. So the joining is the thing that's about what do we share in common, what is it we're hoping to achieve. That's the connection point. So it can't just be you get to scream at me and I get to scream at you. Like, we get to join together. And then I think this thing about they're using the same technology and humanism that I'm talking about in the Book of Onlyness. They're just using it in a flipped way. Right? Mm-hmm. So here they are, fully organized and mobilized, and they certainly have an agenda. I believe that is still a power over model, and onlyness is a power with model. That's so theoretical, isn't it?
You're on campus. This is our business.
But most of the models that we've been operating around patriarchy is a power over model. There are models where it says some people are dominant over other people in order for that power to work. My son, in fact, taking it personal too, my son, in fact, after the election, he's now 14, he was 13 at the time, came home and he had figured out in his entire class whose parents voted for Trump and who his peer group would have voted for Trump. And he kind of had a mapping in his head. This guy, this... And at one point, he got into an argument about another kid about birtherism. And the kid believed that birtherism was valid. And so my son was, like, at dinner having this conversation about, well, how do I have this conversation with this kid? And so we're going back and forth for a few minutes, and I said, so here's the thing. Birtherism's premise is that one person has something, in order for them to win, that another person is lower than that person. That is not an argument. That is not a fact-driven argument. There's no evidence to that argument. It's like the manifesto that came out of Google where women are inferior. And it's based on this research that's just a full lark, and in fact, research being misused. And so you're like, you cannot have that argument. That is not a valid argument to have where one person is lower than another person. So onlyness, fundamental premise, never accepts the premise that one is lower than the other. Anytime it is, that's not onlyness. And I actually write that in the book and spend some time on that because I think that's an old, old, old construct. But I'm actually talking about a very tectonic shift in how do we have a power with model? How do we join together in ways that are as equals with a distributed network model? So in distributed work, which is the opposite of centralized work, what we've done is said we all own a piece of the node, which means I have a ball, you have a ball. Okay, do we want to play ball? But I don't get to throw my ball at you, right? It's not like your ball doesn't exist. So every single person in the system has a ball to play with. That's the fundamental assumption in the distributed world. And so then the question is, do we know how to honor each other's thing? So the sad part about all of this is I've watched this evolution of hate get militarized. In fact, I write a chapter about Gamergate, which is a really terrible thing that the tech industry basically chose to ignore. Twitter basically acted like, oh, women getting rape threats every day? No big deal. And then they just let it keep going. And the same issues have now escalated, so we now have nuclear threats on Twitter. This is a direct linkage and lack of leadership from the tech industry, where they were like, not my problem. And I'm like, yeah, it's going to be your problem. It's going to arrive at your door. And so this is an opportunity, actually, for tech to play a much better role than they've played before because they've sort of acted like passive participants, like, mm-hmm. Wasn't on us, and of course it's on them.